Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Karel Luibe, and this is a presentation on the European Open Science Cloud. First of all, I would like to start by thanking the organizers for inviting me to give this presentation to you. In talking about the European Open Science Cloud, it's good if we first start with a few definitions. The definition of open science. For me, open science is the movement from the way science is done at this moment towards the science we are doing in the future. The way we are doing science in the future, I should say. And in between is a movement of more open access, preferably 100% open access, more fair data, and more involvement of citizens in the science process, either by asking the questions, by evaluating the answers, or by being active in the experiments themselves. From these three, I think the fair data movement is by far the most difficult, most expensive, and most tedious one. I'll come back to that later on. These three jointly form the movement towards open science, but they cannot be done if a number of boundary conditions are not fulfilled. First of all, we need the skills in order to do this. The skills, especially in the data domain, offered either by data stewards or by more knowledge of our researcher on these data or the handling of data. The rewards and recognition system, as we know it at this moment, is too much based on number of publications and number of citations. It should move to a system that is more in line with the open science movement, a system which is more focused on, let's say, the impact of the research work rather than number of publications and number of citations only. And we need a system in order to monitor this, the metrics, to monitor how the progress is taking place in a country, how the progress is taking place in a university, etc. So monitoring this development is an important process as well, boundary condition. These developments jointly, this movement is called the transition, and a transition I tend to call open science transition. We should stimulate and support this transition. Then the definition of open data versus fair data. Open data for me is data that is openly available on the internet, can be accessed and used by everybody, while fair data is data that is findable, accessible, but not necessarily for all and for everything, interoperable, combinable with other data thus, and reusable under certain conditions. Yes, with public funded research, we should strive to a large as possible overlap between these two circles to have as much data that is as well fair as open. So the aim should be towards as fair as possible and as open as possible. If I use the word data, I do not only mean classical data and numbers, I mean basically any digital object or set of digital objects, data, code, other research outputs like publications, etc. These data should have identifiers, we sometimes call them GUPRIs, global, unique, persistent, resolvable identifiers. Often used is the term PID, persistent identifiers that are unique. The standards and codes, in order to make it open and to document it, and using documented formats. And last but not least, the metadata that describe what the data set holds, what it is for, when it can be used, how it was created, etc., etc. For me, EOSC is basically a twin sister or twin brother of what you could call the e-infrastructure organizations, let's say in Europe. The e-infrastructures are offering the store, compute, and connect services needed to, let's say, do management of data, to store data, and to transport data. While the data itself in an organization we call EOSC should be serviced with respect to the data and the interoperability. These two can be seen as a yin-yang situation. Data without infrastructure is nothing, and e-infrastructures without data in them is also nothing. So the two are intimately linked and should form a yin-yang situation. Recently, in a presentation in Davos, the president of the European Union, Ursula von der Leyen, called this a web of scientific insight, or as we call it in our documents, a web of fair research data and services on these data. So we are going to federate existing services, new services, existing data, new data, with the emphasis, by the way, on new, because data are generated much more intensively in the future than they are generated even now. So it will be a virtual space where science producers and science consumers come together, basically an open-ended system, open-ended range of content and services like the World Wide Web is at this moment. And if we start with this development from Europe and play in a significant role as Europe, we can even talk about data made in Europe as a sort of quality mark. At this moment, we are in what is called the first stage of the EOSC development, with a number of European EOSC-related projects that have been done, that have been organized, that have been created. And for the last 2 years, 2019 and 2020, a governance system consisting of an EOSC executive board, of which I am the chairman, an EOSC governance board consisting of the different member states and the different associate countries that are involved in this development, and a number of working groups that are reporting to the executive board and that are basically working in the items like FAIR, the architecture, evaluating and mapping the landscape, rules of participation, the skills set is an important one. And last but not least, the sustainability working group, aiming for the sustainability of this system, looking after what legal entity we need to create, etc. Issues in the transition to the next stage after 2020 are the following. There are a number of boundary conditions, I will come to them in a minute, that have to be met in order to create this second stage. We have to look at what are the core activities after 2020. Of the system we're creating. An important issue is that the data services infrastructures in the countries need to be taken into account and in some cases will be, let's say, modified in time. We are talking about, and I will come back to that in a minute, a legal entity or an association to organize all this. We have to look after the business model in order to get it going and to get it sustained. And the implementation timeline and work plan, but these last are mainly the timelines given by the Horizon Europe program. What are the boundary conditions for this setup? Well, in our view, core funding for EOSC needs to come from the European Union for some time to come. So in the period of Horizon Europe, this would fit as an interesting part of the Horizon Europe developments. It should be inclusive for all the stakeholders involved as much as possible. It should follow a subsidiarity principle. So with the core, we should create something that cannot be done by the individual members alone or cannot be done by the individual countries. These organizations that are going to provide services based on data need to have a shared purpose. We have to work towards a shared purpose of using FAIR data, of creating this federated system. We have to realize, as one of the boundary conditions, that the countries do have different structures, not only with respect to the data landscape, but also with respect to their legal requirements, etc., etc. So that is a boundary condition we have to live with. The system should be as self-inclusive as possible. So if you basically meet the rules of participation, you should be able to become a member. It should be hardware agnostic, speaks for itself. And it should focus also very clear on fair data and create related services on top of these fair data. What are now the core functions for the EELSC Association as of 2021? The association should develop and govern this federating core, which I just described. It should manage a compliance framework, looking after the rules of participation. It should manage a trusted certification, an AII system, so authorization authentication infrastructure. It should manage the PID policies. It should outreach to stakeholders. And the services that are offered and transactions should be monitored. European Commission asked us specifically to look after the EELSC trademark, and it should, last but not least, contribute to the Horizon Europe policy. Why otherwise should we get money from that? If I say manage in this slide, it doesn't mean that this association has to manage all of that themselves. This can be outsourced, but it has to look after that these things are managed. Moving towards this EELSC association, the EELSC governance at this moment is creating a legal entity, a so-called association under Belgium law, an AISBL, or in other words, a not-for-profit organization or a foundation. The criteria for membership are being discussed currently at the EELSC governance, and hopefully we agree on them in the meeting of June. Then a proposal has been drafted for a European partnership, a partnership which is an agreement between the European Commission and this association to be, and this could then start from 2021 to, let's say, monitor together with the Commission the developments that are taking place in line with this from Horizon Europe money. After 2020, by the way, the governance and executive boards along with the EELSC working groups will cease to exist. Of course, this new association cannot set up new working groups. So the adagio is joining the EELSC association is joining the EELSC partnership. In order to join the EELSC association, you should join the EELSC partnership. The EELSC association at its inception is a legal entity with a relatively small size, a small number of people involved. It should be created in an open and transparent manner and should work in an open and transparent manner with a vision and a roadmap for implementing the European Open Science Cloud through a development we call the Strategic Research and Innovation Agenda, or SRIA. The EELSC legal entity will then monitor and coordinate the implementation of the SRIA following a two-tier approach. One tier is that is implemented by the grants following the calls for proposals from the Commission in the Horizon Europe work programs, and the other tier is implemented by the members of the EELSC Association themselves under their own responsibility and their own rules. In a later stage, the EELSC Association will be having a sustainable business model, or should be having a sustainable business model, and the legal entity may also be able to take on or outsource some of the EELSC operational core functions itself, assuming, of course, it is provided the resources to do that. The ambition of the EELSC legal entity is to expand its membership in such a way that it will progressively become a wide, inclusive and representative partnership for the EELSC entities committed to implement the EELSC vision. Timeline. At this moment, the timeline for creating this partnership and creating the association that is part of the partnership is the one given here. Too much detail, let's focus on the center where we are at this moment in the period May-June, the creation of the statutes, the formation, the drafting of the statutes, and later on the final statutes, the looking into the legal status, for example the VIT, and the requirements that are needed by the different organizations. The first iteration we call the minimum viable EOSC. This minimum viable EOSC includes three parts: the core, which I have described, a federation of organizations that can offer data, so the federated data, and the EOSC exchange, a number of organizations that can provide services on top of these data and interact, of course, with the outside world. So the minimum viable EOSC includes the core, the exchange, and the data sets. It must be enabling the federation of existing, but also of planned research data infrastructures. And the disciplinary clusters and regional projects could be a critical first step for this federation. We aim to begin with a simple use cases where the data are not only fair, but also open, in order not to have the sensitivity of closed data involved. Functions of the core, as I mentioned before, is providing means to discover, share, access, and reuse data, and offer the initial services for that. The core will not store, transport, or process data, at least not initially, and most likely not later on. And it should be used as widely as possible, so it will be accessible to any authenticated user to promote an open research across Europe. Here we have the list of the coverage of what the core should be able to do, or the minimum viable EOSC should be able to do, and this list is in line with what I have discussed before. A picture to show you the interaction of the EOSC association on the left, the green box, and what we call the minimum viable EOSC it should create, especially the core functions, PID, help desk, other, let's say, internal standards or core services should be offered through the association itself. But most of the services, EOSC services on the right in the green box, should be offered either by projects done through European money or by the members that are members of the association under their own responsibility and rules. Some of the service could come and will come off, in the future from commercial service providers and maybe directly from national funders. The second or third iteration of the EOSC is something where the public funded research and the EOSC exchange servicing that will be expanded to the data and work coming from the public sector in general, so governments, cities, whatever, and the private sectors, companies, industries, where the different data can also be made fair and where they can also be part of the system. Of course, an example here are also the commercial service providers. So the extension to serve the public sector and the industry is foreseen to start around 2024. And in many cases, these are not new users at all. Many of the parties in the public sector and the private sector are already involved in the projects the public-funded research people are doing. Ideally, we would like to create one marketplace, but if different requirements and legislation require it, then there will be different marketplaces around this EOSC core. And with this, I would like to end my presentation and thank you very much for your attention. Have a good afternoon. And let's start questioning.